this guy looks like he's up to no good, or he's on drugs or something.
Looks like a bad dude too. Let me on something.
We have shot fired. We have one suspect down.
They could have very easily killed me when they threw me in the car.
In May of 2020, as the police officer Derek Chauvin was kneeling on George Floyd's neck, his partner, Tu Tao, turned to the horrified onlookers and smirked. That's why you don't do drugs, kids.
This is why you don't do drugs, kids.
This was probably meant as a crass and stupid joke, but it reveals a clear underlying belief system that if you use drugs, or that if police believe you might have used drugs, they have the right to murder you. In this episode, we're looking at how, again and again, police weaponize drug use, either real or invented, to justify their own brutality and to spread misinformation about the nature of crime and society. On May the 26th, 2012, a man named Rudy Eugene abandoned his car on a busy Miami causeway. He then stripped off all his clothes, threw away the Bible he was carrying, and brutally attacked a homeless man named Ronald Popo. Among other injuries inflicted, Eugene repeatedly bit Popo's face, blinding him in both eyes, before being shot dead by a police officer.
Now at 10, calls for help during a deadly encounter.
Beating another man, it's a naked man.
Armando Aguilar, the head of the local police union, immediately went on a media offensive, claiming that Eugene had been on the synthetic cathinone drug known as bath salts.
Story out front tonight, drugs known as bath salts being blamed for a gruesome scene in Miami. This is a naked man. He was shot dead on Saturday by police because he was gnawing off another man's face.
This story of a crazy new drug that can make people literally eat each other was seized on by the press, and sensationalist headlines about how cathinones turn people into homicidal zombies are still being recycled around the world to this day. The only problem with this narrative is that there is zero evidence for any of it. Aguilar had claimed Rudy Eugene was on bath salts almost immediately after the attack itself, before any toxicology tests had even been done. When Eugene's toxicology report came in weeks later, no bath salts were found at all. The only drug found in Eugene's system was cannabis, but in such tiny amounts that it's almost certain he hadn't consumed any that day or been high at the time of the assault.
If people could just think about caffeine or amphetamine, they basically understand the effects of bath salts. Bath salts, they give you a little boost, maybe some euphoria at large enough doses, but the effects that were described in Mr. Eugene's case, like violence, I have never seen anything like it, and people have studied bath salts in the laboratory, in humans, and have never seen anything like that.
So why were police so keen to spread this bath salts narrative? Well, some journalists have suggested it was to distract attention from the fact that, though Eugene was clearly disturbed, Miami police had shot dead yet another unarmed African-American man. The police trusted in the media's age-old readiness to sensationalize drug scares, and it worked. The story became about a killer drug, not a killer cop. And this seems to happen again and again. In October of 2014, a white Chicago police officer shot 17-year-old Laquan McDonald 16 times. As major inconsistencies emerged in the official account of the shooting, both police and the media resorted to old patterns, casting doubt on McDonald's own reputation. And as usual, they used drugs. The claim here was that because post-mortem reports indicated that McDonald had PCP in his system, the officer was justified in feeling his life was in danger. From a teenager, he shot 16 times from up to 15 feet away. This relies on certain narratives that police and the media have spread about PCP for decades. PCP is a dissociative drug, often known as angel dust, that sometimes makes people act like this.
I've always been interested in dolphin intelligence. Using PCP, especially with dolphins, was just wonderful. I mean, you can just go straight into, you know, communication with them.
But there have also been urban myths circulating since the 1970s that PCP makes users hyper-violent, giving them superhuman strength.
Stories like you had to shoot somebody 38 times in order to stop them because they were on PCP. There is no drug on the planet that behaves like that or give a human superhuman strength.
One of the things that's unique about trials that involve law enforcement officers
is that they start with the presumption that the officer was justified, regardless of the circumstances. And so for a defense attorney who's representing a police officer, what they will do is, number one, reinforce that belief and narrative by attacking the victim and basically putting them on trial and saying, see, this person, you know, regardless of what they were doing in the moment, they were not a good person. You know, they used drugs.
Do you think Laquan McDonald has been put on trial in some way?
Oh, absolutely.
Absolutely.
It brought prior bad acts of a juvenile. Who did nothing that night. He didn't threaten anyone. He never made any of the other officers feel like they were in harm's way.
In 2016, when a white cop was charged with manslaughter over the shooting of the unarmed black man, Terrence Crutcher, a defense team also claimed she feared for her life because she suspected Crutcher might have taken PCP.
Shelby's attorney is calling the report confirmation that her client believed Crutcher was under the influence of PCP during his deadly encounter with the officer last month.
The same defense that police suspected PCP use so felt in enough danger to deploy brutal force was used all the way back in 1991 by the cops who brutally beat Rodney King. The LA riots began when those officers were acquitted by an all-white jury the following year. And it's not just exotic synthetic drugs like PCP and bath salts which are weaponized in this way. Even widely enjoyed drugs like cannabis are used by law enforcement to justify killing. In February of 2012, when George Zimmerman followed 17-year-old Trayvon Martin as he walked home in Florida, he reported to police that Martin looked like he's on drugs. He then shot Martin dead. The case shocked America and the world. But a major part of the legal defense that saw Zimmerman get away with the killing was that Martin had THC, the active agent in cannabis, in his system.
The jury in the George Zimmerman murder trial is expected to learn today that Trayvon Martin had marijuana in his system when he was shot.
One of the things that Zimmerman's, the defense team, tried to do was to say that Trayvon was high on cannabis, because Trayvon had 1.5 nanograms per milliliter of THC, the active component of marijuana, in his system. Now, 1.5 nanograms is so small that it's below the sort of placebo levels that we see in our participants who had not smoked that day.
We see this again and again. The idea that police officers suspected cannabis use and thus feared for their lives and had to deploy lethal force has been used as a defense in the killings of Philando Castile, Michael Brown, and Keith Lamont Scott, among others.
So when we think about once the cops have killed a black person and they claim that the black person used drugs, so what the cop is counting on is counting on the population to have the same sort of screwed up views about drugs as police do. So if you're using drugs, then that means you're immoral. And if you're using this drug, that means you're a bad person. And therefore, you probably didn't give the cop any chance or any choice but to kill you.
Law enforcement, politicians, and the media failing to tell the truth about drugs is nothing new. But the harm this causes is brought into sharp focus when there's a face and a name attached. When you actually hear an officer joking about drugs as his partner kneels on a man's neck.
So when we think about the cops and when they say things like, we behaved exactly like we were trained, it's important for the public to understand that the cops rarely make these mistakes when they're dealing with people other than racial minority. The press helps to create the smokescreen as well, because it's a great story and they want to keep the story going. Meanwhile, the victims suffer.
This is one of the subtle, easily missed ways that reveals how the war on drugs can so easily slip into simply becoming a war on people. These lies and false narratives have been part of the war on drugs since it first began. Perhaps counteracting them can be part of starting the process that brings it to an end.
We'd like to congratulate drugs for winning the war on drugs.